Welcome to the Pyrmont site for the self-guided field trip. What we're going to be doing on this trip is looking at our Hawkesbury sandstone, looking at any igneous intrusions into that sandstone, any faults that have occurred, and we're also going to look at some of the stabilisation measures that they've put in to protect the public. The geology map showed us that we were in RH Hawkesbury sandstone. It also showed us that there's a dike running roughly north-south through the centre of Pyrmont, so we'll keep an eye out looking for that. It also showed us that to the northeast, in the corner over there, we have man-made fill. This is where we've got the wharf structures, etc. Now let's look at the general sandstone that we have. So Hawkesbury sandstone, a quartz sandstone, we're expecting thick beds, sub-horizontally bedded, possibly some cross bedding, maybe some joints cutting through that rock. Now let's look at the rock behind me and see what we can see. So we can see sandstone, quartz sandstone, thick beds, sub-horizontally bedded. I think I'd notice that this lower bedding plane here is quite undulating and wavy. It's actually an erosion surface. This can be confirmed if we look just above that erosion surface. We've got these zones or shale clasts. So this is where the fine silt material has been brought down in the flood and mixed up in the sand. And so you end up with these blobs of shale or shale clasts. So it's clearly an erosion surface. Other than that, the other beds are quite planar. If we look in detail at each bed, some of them are cross-bedded. So the one just here, I can see the cross-bedded pattern throughout the rock form when it was still a soil. Other beds though are quite massive. There's no indication of any cross-bedding in those units. If we look now at other structures throughout the rock mass, we can see some joints. So there's a joint surface just here, orientated in this direction. Then if we look up a little higher, there's another couple of joint surfaces running in this direction. These ones are going through about three beds. This one's just a single bed here. What you can see with these ones being inclined this way and actually daylighting and coming out of the slope is that that makes this block unstable or potentially unstable. So what they've done to ensure that this block stays where it is they've put in bolts there to tie this block into the block behind it. The basic stabilization method is to, rather than have two isolated blocks, is to stick them together such that they become one block and then the center of mass is safely within the rock mass. So the idea is to prevent shear along that joint surface. So the bolts can apply a normal stress across the surface, which increases the effect of the friction angle, as well as applying some cohesion by the actual dowel action of that bolt. Before we go and look at the different parts or the different sites or stops on this field trip, we need to remember safety. First thing, you're out in the sun, make sure you've got a hat, bring some water, some food with you. Shops are expensive here. When you're at each site, please don't stand on the road and please don't stand in gardens and things, so stay where it's publicly and legally accessible. Whenever you're near a face, always look up. Make sure there's nothing unstable. If there is, keep well away from it. Keep away from any body that looks aggressive. You may find in some of the areas that there might be people, homeless people in areas that they've taken up. Please don't go and disturb them. So keep well away. We can still see our exposures without disturbing people. We're currently at Point Street over the light rail, and we're looking at the cutting that the light rail goes through. So it's predominantly sandstone, as discussed before, but what we can see about halfway along is that we can see a vertical feature. So it looks like a grey vertical line, I guess. So that's where the dike that runs through Pyrmont that we see on the geology map runs through this site. It looks grey because they've put shotcrete over it, so they've sprayed concrete onto that dike. And the reason for that is that the dike will erode more rapidly than the sandstone. So we don't want it to look like we see it at Bondi. So what they do is they put mesh in, some drainage then, and then put shotcrete over the top, and that stops the erosion. The drainage stops the water pressures building up behind the concrete and popping the concrete off. If we look to the about one third of the way down the face, we can see another grey band. This is a horizontal band. That's a shale interbed. So there's shale within the Hawkesbury sandstone as per the geology map, and this is one location where you can find it. That again will erode faster. So if you get a section of shale that's eroding, it'll undercut the sandstone blocks that aren't eroding. And eventually it undercuts the center of mass and the block just topples straight out. So two things we do. One of them is we stop the erosion, and again we put mesh, then drainage and shotcrete. The second thing we do is that we can bolt the blocks above the shale. So we put bolts through that block into the next block. Thus, we're moving the center of mass further into the rock mass, and so that it will remain stable for a lot longer. So doing those two measures will solve your problem. Recently, only about a week ago, they came through and did more stabilization. So on the other face, they've put in a whole lot of mesh. They've basically meshed the whole face, and then they've put rock bolts in to support both the mesh and also the various blocks of sandstone. I guess the reason for meshing this whole side and not the other side is that the toe of this slope is right where the light rail's going, whereas there's a bit of a runoff zone on the other side. Right, we're currently in Carmichael Park. First to note, there's a lot of landscaping here. Please don't walk on the plants that the locals have planted, or they'll be chasing me. This park was actually previously a quarry. It's where they got the building stones, so the blocks of sandstone that they used to build the older buildings in Sydney. There's currently another quarry a couple of roads away, which they're using to repair those sandstone buildings. If you look around this area, what we can see is a lot of stabilization works. There's a lot of undercutting via erosion, and also people have undercut the blocks of sandstone above. And so they've had to put bolts in to hold those blocks against the blocks behind them. If we look just here, we can see the joints opening up. And so these are clearly potentially going to topple out or shear through the base and fall out. Particularly where we've got small shale bands beneath it, so it's easy to just topple out. So what they've done is they've put bolts in here, and so those bolts will go through several of these blocks back into the rock face to hold those on. They may come back and redo this one, as these look quite open. Other parts of the quarry, you'll see a lot more steel support systems. You'll also see steel columns where they've placed it into essentially K's where it's been heavily undercut. Another thing you'll see is a special weathering feature, which we also see at Bronte, which is a honeycomb weathering. Now, honeycomb weathering is usually associated with salt. So the salt gets into between the quartz grains, it then crystallizes, swells, breaking the grains apart, creates little voids. And then you get wind starts to come through, swirls in those little voids and starts to open up the little hole. And so you get this honeycomb type effect in your weathering. The further that goes, eventually the whole sheet falls down and it restarts again. And you can see that in various locations on this cutting. Okay, we're standing at Fish Market Station now, just at the bottom of the stairs. And what you can see next to me is a fault zone, or a shear zone, about a metre wide. The amount of movement or shearing along it, we can identify by looking at the bedding planes and the shear of those bedding planes. So I think if we identify this mark here between the cross-bedded material and the not cross-bedded sandstone, we can identify about a metre and a half up on the right-hand side the same bed. And so we've had shearing down the shear plane. And so we've got a normal fault at this location. So you can come along, have a look at this in detail. Also check under the stairs where it's tends to get a little wider as well. Just to the south of this location and to the south of the station, there's a small dike that you can probably observe just from the other side of the railway station a little bit further down. Please don't walk down to it though, obviously, because it's on the railway tracks. Thanks for joining me on our walk around Pyrmont. The rock explosions and things aren't quite as exciting as some of the other field trips, but we do see some really good examples of different types of stabilization and the challenges that you have in an urban setting. The other good thing is this whole field trip ends in the fish markets, so I guess I'm off to the fish markets and I'll see you there. That'll do.